Mic test 1 2, mic test 1 2.
Mic testing.
Alfie, welcome to the crib, man.
Hey.
Welcome to Let's Do Humans podcast.
Let's Do Humans podcast.
Yeah.
I'm intrigued. I asked you, innit, how this name come about, innit?
Yeah, you asked
on text.
Do you know what's actually incredible about what you did? Because you're the first person that, when I invited you initially, you actually put it on me. You made me question myself. And then that's when I know, okay, go. I'm onto something right now. This is serious, guy.
Thank you, man.
Because usually when I invite people, like, the conversation just kicks off straight away. It's like, oh, how are you? How's your podcast? And yeah, I'm kind of interested. I'm going to check out some of your work. You're straight up like, what are your goals for the end of the year? What are you trying to achieve? Like, what does the logo symbolize? And I was like, boy, he's really put me in a corner here. But the thing is, yeah, like, it actually got me thinking, and I really appreciate that, because I do have goals, but I realize that I don't have strict plans, you know what I mean? Written down ideas and step-by-step guide as to how I'm going to achieve them. Like, I do know the amount of subscribers I want. I know the amount of listening time I want, but how am I actively going to achieve that? And you put it on me and you really got me thinking. And now I'm like, wait, I really need a structure to this. Do you know what I mean?
Perfect.
And that's why, like, I find you incredible. And that's when I went, okay, cool. I definitely want him on now. Like, I'm definitely intrigued and I want to hear more about the story, more about the man. But yeah, tell the people out there, who's Alfie, before we get this cracking?
Well, I guess I'm a business guy and an investor. Yeah. I've been on a mad journey. Do you know what I mean? The last sort of, let's call it 12, 13 years have been a bit of a roller coaster.
Yeah.
From first starting in an industry. Let's start from there. And just making your way with not having too much, but just raw energy.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not one of these people that was went to university, got a degree or anything of that nature. I just had energy, and that's why a lot of people always wanted to fuck with me, because I'll just make stuff happen just through my energy.
So when did your schooling end, though?
I was in Surrey. In Surrey. Well, it was younger life in East, then Surrey, if you call it your teenage years.
Okay.
So I went to a school in Surrey there. And it was a bit of a madness, you know, because the area was heavily white. It's just what it is, isn't it? Yeah. I had opportunities there, but it was a bit of a madness. And long story short, in and out of school. In and out of school. I just was never really interested in learning. The only thing I was ever really interested in when I was at school was art. That was it.
Well, in terms of like drawing or like...
creatively. Yeah. I used to make my own clothes. You know, I used to cut up my own jeans, stitch on pockets, just things of that nature. They only call it the interest I had with regards to school. But anyhow, fast forward a few years and I got myself into a working career, because I always like, I'm not going to pursue education. I'm going to pursue just earning peas.
How do you know that from a young age, though? Like, where did that drive come from to just pursue peas? And you knew that you weren't a educational or like your standard academic sort of like individual?
Well, my parents are Nigerian, so they're always like, study your book. You know them ways.
I'm African, I can relate. Yeah.
You know them ways. But I just never saw that as me, man. I always just felt I had too much energy inside me to do that. When I was at school, I just never paid attention to too much. Do you know what I mean? And the fact that I left school and I was still able to get semi-decent grades, I was just like, okay, so I know I've got some of the smarts within me, but this isn't my route. But I guess the real area I got that from is just seeing hustlers. Like, my uncle was a hustler.
Oh, for real?
Yeah, my dad is an absolute bad boy hustler. He was good at that. Do you know what I mean?
What were they hustling, though? What type of stuff were they doing?
So my dad was a businessman.
Yeah.
So he used to sell sugar and oil.
Oh, wow.
So he done extremely well. Yeah. But because he was chasing that, we didn't see him as much. Mm. But we got to see that lifestyle of, you know what, someone will come and have mad dough.
Yeah. You realise that it's attainable as well.
100%. This is a major thing for a lot of people that I kind of feel sorry for sometimes. If you don't see it, you don't... You know when people say, you got to believe it, you see it when you believe it? Mm. Yeah. I understand that. But if you can't see anything at all, if you're almost like... You're boxed in prison, sort of. How are you meant to sort of dream? And my dad, just because he's flamboyant, made us big time dreamers. Every single one of us, as brothers, there's four of us, were all big time dreamers, because we just saw affluence, man. Like, we just saw him being able to ball. Don't get me wrong, he went up and down yo-yo-ish, but when you're exposed to seeing it, good things.
Yeah, but did he bring you into that business world, or were you able to see how he was functioning as a businessman?
Not
or,
at all.
Okay, so you just saw the fruits of his labor, not actually... Yeah.
Exactly that.
Yeah.
Exactly
it's incredible that. You said that, because I was actually speaking to one of my friends yesterday as he was dropping me off somewhere, and he was like, in his circle, in his environment, he only knows one person who's rich. Mm. And so to him, it makes it like completely unattainable because he doesn't believe it. He hasn't seen it. Yeah. And I was like, look, I've got a circle of friends whereby... they can pick up their phone and literally everyone they contact has some form of wealth or has some sort of business or something going on. So they believe in it and they know that it's attainable. Yeah. So it's really important to be able to see it, around you and access it. Yeah. And also for it to be relatable to you. So you're seeing it from someone who looks like you. 100%. You know what I mean? Because if you're seeing it and everyone that's attained all of these things don't look like you, it makes it that more bit of a distant thing than it is a reality.
Very, very true. Mm. I mean, what you said absolutely is spot on, but that's not an excuse. Mm. Not in today's day and age. I believe that's absolutely true, but you're never much more than a few clicks and a bit of confidence away from meeting somebody.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean? Mm. Like, you can put yourself out there to go and see it. Do you know what I mean? But you've got to, this is it, you got to have mad desire for it.
100%.
You know what I mean? If you've got the desire, like, you can either be boxed in and say, this is you, and that's cool, if that's you, or you can go, I want more, and get a first. And that first will make you do things that most people won't do.
Yeah.
Even if it is just putting yourself out there. As we were speaking before we started, you used to host networking events.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people that won't do that, but you might host an event, meet one person, they open up doors for you, 100%, you're gone.
Yeah.
So for me, it's important to, if you want it, push yourself out there and see, you know.
Yeah. So one of the things that drew me to you as well is when I first came across your page, because you've been putting a lot of work on the social media, I'm going to put all the links in the bio and stuff, was you're a ring guy. And I'm a ring guy myself, yeah. But then I realized that our rings must be different, because I started reading into a lot of your content that's out there.
You're that guy, man. You read it properly. Yeah?
I read it properly. I read it properly, and love I went that. Deep, and I realized that you're of a different caliber. Like, you've seen a different type of lifestyle.
Thank
and
you,
my rings are like the £5 from Shoreditch. And I know you've been in a lifestyle where you've seen things. You've attained things. Can you tell us a bit more about like your how you started up in investment and like sort of like some of the financial gains that you made and trials and tribulations?
Of course. So I mean, at the end of the day, it was very, very learn hands on DIY sort of stuff. You know, I was introduced into sort of investment broking, investment sort of sales.
How do you go from someone who, because obviously when I hear about people getting into investment or working in Canary Wharf with the banks and stuff, I'm always thinking it's these super smart kids who attain the knowledge by taking various courses or going to specific universities and so forth. So how did you get into it?
I mean, to be fair, there's two routes. There's that route, where you go and work for a big bank, or there's another route where you go and sell commodities and you work for a brokerage. I took the second route because I didn't have the qualifications. For me, it was just the highest level of sales, the sales that has, I mean, the only other sales that I knew that could give me that type of lifestyle, but probably was a bit more harder, was recruitment. And I just didn't find the allure.
It's a commission based work where commission based work to,
exactly that. So I met a guy and he invited me onto his sort of sales firm, and he just took a real liking to me. The real reason he took a real liking to me to begin with was because at first, you know, it was back in the day where you used to have to learn scripts. And the script was like maybe 7-8 pages. And there was all these young kids who got invited there, all of us. And out of maybe 8 of us, I was the only person that knew it word for word. Word for word.
Oh, wow.
Word for word. But that's just me, man. Like, if I say
you put it working in the time, I guess.
I just always do that. It's always been me. Yeah. Especially if I can see the result being massively beneficial. For me, that's enough. So basically, I was the only person that did it. And then he went, do you think you could say that whole pitch in front of everybody? And I was like, okay. 60 people, man. 120 eyeballs.
Damn. And that was your first time doing such a speech,
Done it.
For real.
Done it. And from then he just went, you know what, you're a different type of person, you know. And then he started saying things like, look, I'm going to go set up my own sales company. Get involved with me. You know, you'll be able to make a lot of money very, very quickly. We'll build this and we'll build something very iconic. So when somebody's saying that to you and nobody else is saying it to you, you've got other people around you doing, you know, decent things, my brother especially, doing really big things, making himself a name for himself in the music industry. It just made me go, you know what, let me invest my energy into this guy. And that was really the beginning of that whole transition.
And what was that transition like? What was the journey? So how did the business set up and where did it take you in terms of like as an individual and lifestyle wise?
Okay, so it's set up and it's just like any, think of any story, Steve Jobs, think of any of them, any of them where it's like grind.
Mm.
So we didn't have any dough, really, really. I had to actually take out a loan. I took out an egg loan, $5,000, I remember.
Wait, so hold on. So he invited you to join his business. There was no funds there.
Exactly that.
It's like coming to Netflix and chill when you don't even have a TV.
Exactly that. Exactly that. But you know, it's all part of the journey, man. It makes 100%. It beautiful. So we had, I remember when we first started off, we was eating pot noodles for lunch.
Wow.
That was it, you know. We just had no dough, man. Yeah. And at the time I just done this lighter life diet thing. You heard of it before? I went from 18 and a half stone to like maybe 14 stone.
Wait, that's it.
So yeah, but what wasn't sick is I was still wearing the suit from 18 and a half stone because I had no dough. So it was like MC Hammer baggy. You know, them sort of styles. So it was just all sort of grind. Everyone sort of, well, it was only me and him, and then we invited a couple other people, and then slowly, gradually got first few sales in. Clients started to recommend us, started to build slowly, and then fast forward, let's call it a year and a half, 2 years, money just started coming in.
When you talk money, like what was the startup? So initially, how much were you guys bringing in, like for yourself? And
not much, 5, 10, 15,000 per month. But that didn't last too long.
Is that profit there or was that gross?
Nah, that was gross. That was gross. And then we took it to a level where we was probably bringing in about 100.
Oh wow.
And at that level per month, yeah, you can earn a tiny bit, but then we quickly got it up to like a mil.
Oh, for real.
And then things just changed.
Yeah, so when things changed for the business, how did it change you though as an individual? What was you doing at this time then? Like, now you got all this money rolling in.
So this is the thing, I didn't have financial literacy. I understood that investment, but it's a different story between understanding something theoretically and practicing it yourself. Especially when you go from where you were to pop and bang. You know, when it goes pop and bang, and I mean really you start earning that type of money, you almost want everyone in the world to know, you want everyone to see it. So that's kind of the route I took. And on top of that, because it was, although it was mad flamboyant, obviously I see my dad doing the madnesses. I really wanted to emulate that as well.
What type of madness were your dad doing though? Man,
he bought a Rolls Royce for my brother when he was 7.
No way.
Yeah, we got chauffeur driven to school. But that's the good side of it.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be the turn up for 3 months of out of the last 5 years that we'd have.
And then
the
rest of it disappears back into business.
And with no dough. Mm. And then it'd be left to my mum with no dough. Work three jobs, 2-3 jobs regularly. So it was like extreme to extreme. And I guess, you know, now you're asking me that, that probably was the imprint that I had as well. I'll go from extreme, earn mad dough in a month.
So you thought that was the norm, basically.
I'd earn like mad dough in a month and be broke one day before the end of the month. Not broke, but a few hundred pounds, a few thousand pounds, considering you was earning 50, 60, 70 months, 100, you know? And be
so you earn around what, 60 grand, 60-70 grand a month?
But about the heights of it, for a solid year and a half, there's averaging 100
grand. Oh, amazing. You know, I don't know, I think I heard this somewhere or read it. I'm not sure if it's you that put it out there yourself, but there was a time where you took your car keys somewhere to have them bust down.
Yeah.
Can you explain to the people what it feels like to take your car keys somewhere to have them bust? Or was that, did I read that directly from one of your...
No, that's absolutely true. I've actually got them here as well.
Oh, for real?
Yeah
so what did you do? Tell me that.
Well, but basically, it's always, you know, when you're in sales and I was hanging out in London, and at the time I was around these metal trader guys as well, and they were earning serious dough trading metals. And they were just doing seriously well. London Metal Exchange, I believe. I was introduced to them. And I was putting myself in circles around like the Arabs. People just with mad affluence. That's what I wanted to get myself
people
around.
That probably didn't even have to work as hard as you did for the
100%.
And so you're trying to like play catch up.
100%. We're talking about people that were, at that time, I was rolling with people who were, you know, business libs. Do you know what I mean? Like, they love my energy. The type of money that I thought was a lot, but I had to be around that. Because if you think you're earning 100 and you think that's a lot, when the world is out there and you've got people who are making, let's call it a million a month, and people above that, then that's the type of circles I want to be around. And everybody back then was having these nice watches, Pateks, APs, things of that nature. I liked it, but I thought, how can I differentiate myself? And I've always been like that. I was a guy in the clubs, anyone knew me, I was baked completely top to the bottom. I'd wear pink trainers, all that sort of stuff. Identity crisis, everybody had to see me. And I just thought, you know what, everyone's got this, everyone's icing out watches, buying these type of watches. I'm just going to get something that no one wants to do. No one will want to do it. And I just iced out every one of my keys. I had three cars, two bikes, two Harleys, just iced out the whole lot.
No way.
Yeah. Spent 60 grand doing it.
That's the thing, because it's incredible that people say like the circle you surround yourself with, it can either make you or break you. But then for you, it must have been like the gift and the curse at the same time, because you're seeing all these affluence, you're seeing all of these people with all of this wealth and all these businesses. But then at the same time, you're trying to keep up with people that are on a completely different like stratosphere to yourself. So how does one balance that, your mindset, to be able to control yourself?
Education, man.
Yeah.
Education. It's like, if you look at my, I've got a thing called the Costa Swag. I'm not sure if you've seen it.
I think I've come across it. Yeah.
Costa Swag is a concept that literally explains what you've just said to a T, because this is the thing. When you're playing catch up, you're using your energy to buy these objects. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when you're doing that, yeah, you can never win, because it's your energy, man. You have to sleep. You're going to get tired. You're going to get bored. You're using human emotion, which is energy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, for me, energy is energy, emotion. Yeah, for me, yeah, to buy these things. And you're always playing catch up, because it's always the next until you then end up in bankruptcy and you can't do it and everyone scatters.
Yeah.
So for me, there wasn't any balance. It was just always going next. So exactly as you said, it was the gift and the curse.
Yeah.
You'd be high, then you'd be low. You'd be high. You're just juggling these emotions, man. It was crazy. But then after a little while, when you sort of reflect, especially in the darker times, and you go, what did I actually take from this?
Yeah.
And that's what made me now start saying, you know what? That's why you have to buy income generating assets. Yeah. You have to. Because if it's not your physical energy paying for it, then enjoy as much as you can. Yeah. But if, like, for example, if it's like a business paying for your lifestyle, great. But if you have to go and work to pay for your lifestyle, that is a rat race. You're going to be looped and looped and looped and looped in that.
100%.
So, you know, that's a massive lesson that now, you know, before I buy anything, I've got to think, is it my energy? And if it is my energy, how much of it is it costing me? Do you know what I mean? So, like, real cost.
So all of this enlightenment came from like your bankruptcy situation. And how did that come about?
Just literally because I owed the tax man a hell of a lot of money.
Yeah,
because as I said...
Were you not paying taxes though? Like, was there no structure in place for you to understand what the taxes were?
I was just ignorant.
Yeah.
I've got to be honest. I was just ignorant. You know, I just... I always just thought that... I'm not going to ever blame anybody. I'm responsible is one thing I live by. Yeah?
Accountability is key. Yeah.
I'm responsible full way. Yeah? I'm not going to blame anybody. But when you're in that sort of mesmerized lifestyle where everything is, you can every month you can re-up. You're just told, listen, save 20% or earn and then just pay. And you just do that, you know? But then after a couple of years of kind of like just paying minimal amounts,
yeah,
I just realized, especially when you want to buy a property, like for your family or whatever, whatnot, you're like, okay, I need to start really, really being serious and responsible about this.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as I popped up my head and paid a decent amount of tax, yeah, that's when I was like, okay, well,
hold on a minute.
Okay, so before you was paying this, now you've just gave us this. Explain.
Yeah.
And then they started off in an inquiry, and the inquiry just ended really, really badly. Like, they wouldn't let me do any deals with them. Started talking about seizing assets, all that sort of jazz. And yeah, that was it.
But how did that feel like, though, emotionally for you, like going through the bankruptcy state? Because I'm sure there was a lot of people that were relying on you as well as the brethren or the family.
That's the hardest thing.
Yeah.
You know, so my little brother is an absolute G, because he's chasing his dream, following, I don't like that word, he's following his dream, he knows his path. But the one thing he's done, which is very, very, very good for, I think, for entrepreneurial people, is you have to be selfish. What's the best way of being selfish? If you're single. If you're alone, as soon as you bring family, kids, people that you love, parents, whatever, you start taking care of them, that is when it becomes such, like, you just asked how it was.
I can imagine.
It was so difficult for me because
you had a family at the time as well, didn't
you? Yeah. When it actually popped, like, and just collapsed, I had two children, missus, my mum retired. It was just mad.
So you'd retired your mum as well at this time?
Yeah. That is probably, of everything, that's probably the only thing that I really care about.
Yeah.
So that's the only really goal I really care about.
You didn't send her back to work though when you were going bankrupt, were you?
No. Even to this day, like, she's kind of nice.
Oh, that's amazing. But,
and she only has to do certain things because she's still a young, beautiful mother, do you know what I mean? So she doesn't want to be bored. But yeah, that was one of the big things for me, man. Yeah. So when that actually happened, I had to mask a lot. But I guess the one good thing about buying all the stupid things you're selling all the stupid things.
Yeah. So now you come crawling back with all your all your belongings,
But when that happened, again, another lesson, because you realise what the true value is. It's what, you know, what you're willing to pay is very different to what somebody else is willing to pay.
Yeah, 100%.
And that's a mental thing as well. For anybody who's been in a position where you've had to sell something that you held dearly, and you go through this kind of battle where you're saying to yourself, you know what, why did I hold it so dearly?
Yeah.
And then people are offering you silly money, and then you accept that silly money because you need it.
But did you turn around to friends? Was this like you trying to like short your stuff back to your boys and stuff, or were you taking them to the coffee shops and stuff?
Nah, because my actual boys weren't in the same sort of financial position.
Oh, okay. Were you carrying them as well at the time?
I wouldn't say carrying them. Would I go and party and spend and pay for everything? Yeah.
You're that guy.
I'm a big giver.
I'm a big...
Some of my goals now are still to be able to do things of that nature. Maybe not in that regard, but I'm a big giver. So I was always, always making sure... Because I want people to have a lovely time around me. So that was a big thing
for me. Did it all know that you were going through this bankruptcy?
No one.
Serious. And how long did you keep that secret for?
No one.
Serious.
No one. Until the... Even when it actually... when it was actually like kind of made official, nobody, because of embarrassment.
Yeah. I think that's some of the dangers we go through as men as well. Like withholding information when we're going through like terrible stages in our life and stuff, and being unable to like ask for help. And yeah, it kind of puts us in that dark place where you're all alone basically in essence. Yeah.
Even as you're saying that now, it's really strange, man. It's giving me goosebumps, man. Yeah. When I actually think of it, it's like, why don't you, for somebody so good at communication, why didn't you speak?
Yeah.
What did you think was going to happen? Like, I remember me and my missus were probably talking like maybe a year and a half ago, something like that nature. And when I was telling her about me going through depression, like the shock on her face, shock on her face, because she knew that things were bad at that time, but I would mask it so well. Because it's all internal, isn't it, really? It's all internal. I'd mask it so well, like I'd try to hide things so well that nobody ever see the real pain he was going through. And I think it is a thing, like just being able to talk about your emotions. But you always think about this. You always think as soon as you expose that side of you, people are going to see you as weak.
As weak, yeah, 100%. Especially if you're the breadwinner as well, like you're the backbone of a family. It's like you feel like the family's going to crumble in essence. Do you know what I mean? If you're not strong, then who else is? But then sometimes you have to realise that there's other people that are capable of lifting you out of that dark hole.
You're absolutely right. But also, something that's kind of counter against that is the fact that when you do tell people, they can't help but naturally worry.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's a human emotion, and that's going to affect their decisions. Do you see what I mean? Like you tell somebody, for example, I'm not saying you shouldn't do this, but you tell somebody you're in a bad financial state, they're not going to continue trying to live their life if they're with you the same way they were. Yeah. It's going to have a knock-on effect. It's going to have a butterfly effect, and you don't know what that's going to do to their decision-making 6 months down the line. It literally could be that. You don't know. Do you know what I mean? So for me, I was always somebody that was like, if I can fix this myself, then I'd rather do that than... And I'm not saying it's right or wrong. It was just what worked for me at the time. I'd just rather just do that because I didn't want to... I understand if you say something to somebody today and it stays in their brain as a mindset as a seed, 6 months' time, what that's grown into, you don't bloody know. You don't know. So it's a very delicate subject.
It's very delicate. So, I mean, how did you take yourself out of this situation then? So, like, you've gone bankrupt now. They've come for all your... Well, did they seize your assets and stuff?
Some of them.
Okay.
Some of them. A lot of things I sold quickly.
Yeah.
Being quite open.
Yeah.
As soon as I kind of... Yeah, I kind of just got rid of stuff.
Yeah.
It was more just that. There was another situation at the time. My brother, who was going through serious mental health, he had to be sectioned.
Yeah.
He was paranoid, schizophrenic. And it was just like an amalgamation of things. It's probably 5 or 6 things that happened all within 2 or 3 months.
Wow.
Yeah.
That must have been a lot. That's a big burden for one man to take. Yeah.
100%, man. 100%. And when that happened, it was just like, I remember like vividly, I had this mattress. And Ben, at the time, the house that we was living in, lovely house, 5-bedroom detached on 3 floors, really lovely house. I was sleeping on a mattress in the floor.
Wow.
A mattress on the floor in a room by myself, not sleeping in the bed with my missus. Because I was just, that was it.
Yeah.
That was it. Grips in me. It made me feel worthless.
Yeah. It's,
genuinely.
It's paralyzing because I've been in that situation before where like everything kind of crumbled around me and I found myself like curled up in bed all the time. It's like you have all these space around you. You might have your apartment or your house or whatever, but you find yourself compounded to this little space there. Like, you're confined to this tiny little space and you don't want to move out of it.
Do you know what I think that is as well? And I've really sort of gone back and analytically looked at that. I think it's because you think that's what you're worth.
Yeah.
I think your self-worth goes so below
you. You're not worthy of all this
space.
You're
not worthy of anything. You're not worthy of anything. I think, for me as well, I think that for my situation, I think you put the worst on you.
Yeah.
You're almost like, that's me.
Yeah.
That's me. I wanna, that's me. What am I? Who am I?
Mm.
Do you see what I mean? So for me, it was like that. And I remember being in that position where I literally wasn't eating the same. My mind was racing, going crazy regularly. And I just, it was.
Yeah.
It was one day for my, I'm trying to think of when this actually, I believe it was my eldest boy, Phoenix. Yeah. When he looked, it was one look that he gave me once that made me kind of go, ah.
I
need to do something. Like, is this, because I have a big thing of, how my actions affecting the people around me?
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? And that made me start thinking, okay, I've used certain things to get anything I want in life before. Goals, whatever, whatnot. Yeah. I've used certain things, call it systems, ideas, methods, hacks, whatever you want to call it, to get my mind in a place. Because it's all born here, isn't it? It's all born here. So I was like, I've used these systems, ideas, whatever, to get my mind in a place that attracts stuff, gets me moving. That's for the more positive and materialistic. That doesn't mean fuck all at all. It means nothing. Yeah. What about my health?
Yeah.
Why don't I try and get myself out of it? Why don't I use it to get myself out of this situation? I'm going to use it. That's it.
So that one trigger was your son. Yeah.
That's the most notable one. Mm. There's probably a few things as well, but that was the most notable one that got me thinking, well, what can I actually do?
Yeah.
It wasn't to go and see anybody. No way.
Yeah.
It wasn't to go and see anybody. And do you know what? Now you're asking me that, I think because my brother was going through like what I call an extreme level of mental health. I'm not trying to topsy-turvy. This isn't top
Trump. He was sanctioned, really.
He was, exactly. Yeah. He was sectioned. And he was, and when we used to go to the hospital to see him, just actually seeing what you're surrounded by, man, it made me just think, who am I to actually say anything about the troubles, the dark place I was in? Do you know what I mean? But I just thought to myself, I can't speak to anybody, I can't speak to my mum, can't speak to nobody, can't speak to my missus, whatever. So this is it. I'm going to work with something.
Mm.
And it's just literally, one thing I've always known is, because there's so many different voices in our head that feed off our emotions, I was just like, if you get what you want out of your head onto something as simple as a piece of paper, what you actually do is you forge a psychoneuromotor activity.
Yeah.
It's literally mind, muscle, mind and body connection, shall I say. And you can actually focus a hell of a lot better. So I thought, you know what, I'm just going to write the goal. And it was just simple. I am healthy both of mind and spirit.
Yeah.
I knew my body was okay, so it was just mind and spirit. I remember the goal.
Mm.
Wrote it out, descriptive why, everything, and just went through a process.
Is that why you're so goal orientated now? Oh, like, just ensuring that you're always like putting it down and manifesting it and going for it. Yeah.
For me, it's funny because when you were saying about your goals, that's why I always, like, I can tell a lot about a person from their goals. Do you know what I mean? I think a lot of people can. But then what a lot of people get lost in is they think, okay, all right, I've got these ideas, my goals, and they think, how am I meant to do it? And they just leave them up here jumbled with so much, man.
Yeah, yeah.
So much.
Yeah, it gets completely mixed up in that, because it's like, I mean, I've got a goal book, so I put everything down. Everything's on paper, but sometimes I find myself like chopping and changing in between the goals and changing dates and moving figures and numbers around all the time.
Yeah.
And that's the issue that I find. It's like they're constantly replaying in my head, but I need to have like the stagnant version of the goal. So like the short term, mid, long term, and just stick to that. Do you know what I mean?
Of course.
And that's the struggles that I find, because I'm always like jumping in between stuff, because in my personal life, I do so many things and it's varied forms of like work and stuff I do. But how do you focus and hone in on the goals?
Because what I've learned is, one major goal probably takes care of 50.
Mm.
Big, big, big bullet there. Yeah. One major goal probably takes care of 50. Mm. So what I tend to do, before I used to be exactly the same as yourself, whereby you'd have maybe 20, 30 different focuses,
yeah.
and you'd like it, and you always feel like you're busy, so that gives yourself a sense of fulfillment.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then what I realised is, if you focus on one goal that is almost audacious, maybe a bit scary, well, definitely a bit scary and big, you'll find that just by the person you're becoming walking down that journey, you're going to get other goals that are in line with 100%. What you wanted anyway. Mm. And when they come, you'd be like, well, I said that before. Yeah. I said I was going to meet that person. Yeah. Nowadays, my goals are a lot to do with connecting with people as well. So it'd be like, well, I said I wanted to meet somebody that did this.
Yeah.
I knew I was going to attract it. So I'm building like this network of not only people, but things, but because of the one major goal.
Yeah, 100%.
You know what I mean? Because of the one major goal. So I think that for me, how do I focus? Because focus is a big thing. And I'm not always focused at all, because I'm probably quite similar to yourself, quite energetic. Yeah. It is just focusing on the larger of the goals as opposed to trying to get a lot done.
Yeah, definitely. Can you tell me, I'm intrigued to learn about some of the lessons that you learned going through like your darker stages. So we're going through a timeline of like the bankruptcy and then coming back up again. Like, what was that like, and what were some of the lessons that you learned that could be of value to others?
Okay. So I think the main thing I'd say that I learned is who you surround yourself with.
Yeah.
You know, you get a lot of yes men.
Mm.
You get a lot of yes men, and it feels great. Yes men feel great. Yeah. What is better than people saying yes to
And when you're the guy, everyone's going to be your yes man. Do you know what I mean?
You get a lot of yes men. And you know, shout out to the people that are around me. I don't hate anybody. I'm not upset with anybody. You know, if somebody's showing you a way to have a ridiculous lifestyle, of course you're going to say whatever to that person.
100%.
But back then, I did have a couple of people around me that were saying no, or were saying other things, but I didn't respect
them. So they're trying
to
encourage you when you were making wrong decisions?
I don't think it was even they're seeing it as wrong decision. I think wrong decisions per se. I think it was more reckless lifestyle.
Oh, okay.
As in, that you're going so far fast without putting a foundation.
Don't go putting diamonds on all your car keys.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. To be fair, I don't think anyone hated that. You know?
Yeah,
I think everyone loved that.
Hell of
I think everyone loved that purely because it was so different to what anyone was doing. We're talking 2012.
That is crazy.
Do you know what I mean? No one was doing that.
Everyone's buying, what was it, Cuban zirconias at that time. Going down Roman Road and spending like 150 on the watch and being a man. I remember that in college, man.
It's funny you say that, because I remember me and my mother, shout out to Benny, man. Yeah. I remember we used to go Trocadero. We used to go by them iced out watches as well that would last for like 3 days. You remember them? They'd last for like 3 days. Yeah. And the colour would go, the stones would drop.
So going green and that. Yeah. Oh, man. It was so mad.
Oh, gosh. That's
since 2012, fun. That's what you did. So what were the people saying to you, and how was you receiving it?
Okay, there's two main people.
Mm.
Okay, so one of them was just like, listen, you don't need to entertain all these people around you. Mm. And just more focus on yourself, which I just took for granted. I was just like, come on, man, I'm having fun, I'm enjoying life. I didn't really understand.
Yeah.
I've always been somebody who likes my alone time a lot.
Yeah.
I like my alone time.
Welcome to the club.
Yeah, I feel like I can do so much when I'm alone.
Mm.
But then as soon as you pop your head out into that lifestyle, party lifestyle. I remember reading Elon Musk when he started doing it. Mm-hmm. And he said that he had to get himself out of it very, very quickly because it's so attractive, it's so tempting.
It's addictive as well.
It's so addictive. So I learned the value of going back to that space and being okay with being by yourself. Not feeling that you're unpopular, you're uncool, you're lonely, nobody cares about you anymore. Just taking strength in by being alone.
Mm.
That was one thing from there. And I guess the other thing as well is just not to judge somebody because they don't have what you have, man.
Yeah.
Is it
hard for you to, so someone who's earning, what, how much were you earning around this time?
It's like 100.
100K? What, a
month.
Wow.
Yeah.
Net?
Yeah.
And how old was you at that time?
27, 28.
It's going to be extremely hard to take people. It's actually, you're like, yo, bro, like, who are you to tell me? Yeah, that's the difficulty.
That's so pompous,
man.
Yeah. It sounds so bad, but that is literally it.
Yeah.
Especially if you're making it yourself.
Mm.
Especially if like, there was, just to go back, especially like when I was first coming up, because I've always, when I first started coming up and I started reading, I've become an avid reader, just loving reading. Mm. The stuff that I was reading, I was just telling everybody because I wanted everyone to have a better life.
Yeah, you're charged up.
Charged up. And people would be like, here comes Alf.
Yeah.
Exactly. They'd be like, here comes Alf. Mm. Here he comes with all of this positive
stuff.
Every
day a new idea. Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It was just like positivity because I was just like, you can, I just, I think it's the first time I just learned, read Think and Grow Rich.
Oh, yeah.
It blew my mind away. I wanted everyone to know.
I wanted everyone to know. Was it the Napoleon one?
Yeah, Napoleon Hill. So yeah, I wanted everyone to know. I think I got that in my library somewhere. Yeah, I did it in my book range. So it was that book, and I just wanted everyone to know. And I quickly started to piss off a lot of people. So then when I started making, though, and I was able to be like, I still hollered at these people because I kind of wanted to put it in their face. Do you know what I mean? I kind of wanted to put it in their face.
Yeah.
I was kind of like, no one can't tell me nothing because it's the same principles I was saying back then that I'm using now, like sorting my mind, to achieve that you lot was laughing at.
Yeah. Do you know what's funny? Because there's actually a quote that says, I'm just going to paraphrase it, but it says, through results come the idea that you're an expert. So people get the perception that you're an expert because you've gained the results. But when you don't have the results, like, who are you? I haven't seen you do it. Like, so where is your proof? Where is your example?
Yeah.
But when you show that to them, then it's like, okay, we can come to you now. You're the expert. You're that guy. You've done it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. But there's also, there's a difference between someone giving you let's call it advice. I think if someone's going to give like advice, like heartfelt advice, you should listen to it. Like that's more like opinion, and it's like where's that emotion coming from? Yeah, that's fine. But then if somebody's posing as an expert, I personally feel they should have been through it.
100%. They have to. 100%.
How are you going to tell somebody unless you've been through it?
Mm.
So I was getting advice from people. People weren't being they weren't posing as expert, but I got the two confused.
So was it like people without money telling you what to do with your 100%.
Money? 100%. Yeah. And it was just more advice. Do you know what I mean? Now I understand the difference between, say, advice from a friendly, loving place and an expert opinion.
Yeah.
Like if I'm going to get an expert opinion, I need to know your credentials.
Yeah.
But if it's advice, I want to, okay.
But how about family, though? What was family saying? And was you receiving everyone the same way? So regardless of whether it was friends or family saying this to you?
I think, again, like, with my family, they weren't really... I was so probably, in my own mind, above like I call it, a level.
Yeah.
Like, I was just like, I'm the guy.
Yeah.
I'm the guy. So I didn't really listen to nobody. So I don't think my closest family said too much to me too often.
What was your influences though around that time? Like, who were the people that you looked up to? I mean, it could be externally or internally. It could be like family, people around you. Like,
my uncle was always a G.
Oh, okay.
Purely and simply because I just saw how he looked after us in the bad times.
Was he the one that was around when your dad wasn't?
So he was always a G. And then my actual influences were people that I, like, so again, Think and Grow Rich talks about MMA, Mastermind Alliance. And one of the things that I used to do regularly, whenever I needed to be alone and not in the fantasy playboy lifestyle, I would just delete my phone book down to 5 people.
Oh, for real?
Down to 5 people.
Yeah.
I was saying, it's funny, someone hit me up on Insta yesterday. One of the big actress, man, he was a sick guy, man. And I went and done some training with him before. And I said to him, look, you delete your phone down to 5 people because those 5 people become your MMA, your Mastermind Alliance. Yeah. They're the people that you're really going to speak to, want to push you, whatever. You're going to hold them to a good
regard. What do you do with the rest when they contact you? Do you completely like shut them
up? Don't answer it.
Yeah.
If I didn't have this is the trick to it. If you don't have the phone number in your phone, don't pick it up. How liberating that is ridiculous.
I can imagine.
So liberating, so liberating. So just doing things like that, I had a few sort of people around me, but my main actual, and this comes from Napoleon Hill, my main actual influences were people that I read their books so well that I felt I knew them.
Okay, for real.
The number one guy is a guy called Jim Rohn. Number one guy.
What was there about him in particular?
His philosophy. His way with words, man. Like, I just emulate. To this day, the guy died in 2013. And he still has a massive impact on everybody in the world. Like, he's the one guy that I think, like, don't get me wrong, I listen to a lot of these personal development guys. And I'm like, yeah, I like what you're saying. I like the movement you're saying. Certain ways that I don't agree with it. I think sometimes maybe it's a bit Americanized or things of that nature. Do you know what I mean?
They're different, yeah.
But Jim Rohn, there's not one of his philosophies that I disagree with.
Oh, for real?
Not one.
What's your favorite philosophy from him, though?
Man, there is absolutely so many.
Yeah.
You have to become more valuable to the marketplace.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. yeah, get
out. So is that one in line with, because I think I saw one of your posts recently was about, no, actually it's an old one that I saw when I first started following you, it's about making yourself indispensable and the importance of, like, when you're in an organisation, so particularly for young people, this would be ideal. So when you get yourself into an organisation, it's not about what you can make. So it's like, I'm not here to make money. You know what I mean? I'm here to make myself indispensable in this organisation. Why is that so important?
100%. Because ultimately, you start a new career or whatever, whatnot, and it's all about, okay, what can I earn and then buy and then show my fruits of labour. I've done it. But like I said earlier on, you get yourself into a loop. It starts off with a Gucci belt, then it goes to the Gucci tracksuit, then it goes to
holidays in Ibiza.
Do you know what I mean? And it's just a, but the thing is, you will get to like 35, 40 and you look back and go, wow, what have I really got?
Yeah.
And my skill hasn't really expelled. I've not really grown massively in any mental capacity. So what have I actually done? Just got a load of things. And these things are worth a fraction of what they were before.
Yeah.
So for me, whenever I do any sort of training with, especially young people, I'm like, forget that. If you was going to, I think the same post you're talking about is, if you was going to be a mechanic, what would be your goal to be? Buy a Gucci belt, buy a Daytona. I think that's what I said. Yeah. To become the best fucking mechanic. That would be, that should be the actual goal.
100%.
So for me, it's just like, and I think that's, it's funny. I was having a conversation with one of my friends and I was just saying to her, you know what, in life, if you become first seen, that means you become attractive. People can see you. I'm not talking about physical looks. I'm talking about people can see what you're doing. They're like, well, okay, I see what he's doing there.
Yeah.
Like what you said about me earlier on. You're like, okay, I want to get on that path. I want to introduce. I want to work with that person, whatever. So the first thing is become, get be seen. Then after that, be indispensable. Be so relied upon that you can command.
100%. I think that's in line with anything that you do in life. So, for instance, I'm doing a podcast about like putting out informative, educational, like business networking content. So that is my indispensability. I want to be that guy, the go-to guy for that type of information. So I'm not focusing on anything else around the whole podcasting world. It's all about me putting out a great content, and that should be the focus of what I'm doing. And then 100%. The rest comes along with it. Because if I'm focusing on anything else, like, oh, what my views are like today, or what's this like today? But when people ask me on the podcast, I'm like, look, I got this amazing guy coming through and I'm going to learn so much from him, and I hope that you learn something from him. And that's the, should be the key focus in anything anyone does.
That, and listen, and the thing about that as well is, what price can you put on that?
Yeah.
You can't put a price on that. If somebody can put a price, for example, they say, you do all of this work at whatever standard, and I'm going to give you £2,000 per month, whatever, whatnot. You're boxed.
Yeah,
that's 100%. It. You've got floor and ceiling. You're boxed. Yeah. If you're in that box, but you don't accept the amount.
Yeah.
Forget the £2,000, and you give your energy to everything every single day. Quite naturally, you're going to grow to expand that box.
100%.
So people are going to say, "Okay, I can see what he's doing. He's too big for this. We have to give him something more." And that's the whole value about being seen and then being indispensable. Yeah. It's massive.
That's it. Can you tell me a bit more about the system? Because that's the big thing that you're pushing right now on social media. Like, you're going hard on social media. I just love what you're doing. I'm always checking for your stuff now.
Thanks.
So you're like my own personal British Gary Vee.
Thank you, man.
Yeah, you're that guy. Do you know what I mean?
You know, it's funny you said that.
Yeah.
Do you know how funny? Do you know what? The universe is a great thing. So somebody sent me a meme and I didn't want to throw it out because I didn't want to be too, I didn't want to be pompous, but I probably am going to send it out. Somebody sent me a meme that says, they can have Gary Vee, we've got Alfie Vee.
100%.
And I thought, wow, what an accolade.
It's more relatable because the thing is, like, you sound like me, do you know what I mean? You look like me, but whilst Gary Vee, as we talked about earlier on, it seems like it's a bit distant. So definitely, like, I check for your stuff and I get the same energy and the same vibe, and it pushes me the same way. Like, tell us about the system, your angle that you've been pushing on there.
So basically, I've been teaching people the importance of writing goals for ages. As I said before.
Which is why you put it on me.
You
got me thinking now.
First thing, look. Do you know what 100%. I mean? Like, you can't mess with it. And also because if I'm going to get myself around someone like you, it's a two-way thing.
Yeah.
If it's just me, bang, bang, it's almost prescriptive. It's almost like I'm lecturing. That's not what I like to do. I like to feed. I like us to vibe. And that's how synergy is formed.
Yeah.
And synergy can create, well, it's not even can create. Synergy has created everything. Do you know what I mean? Synergy has. So for me, like, that's why I'm always on goals. Now, the system in per se is literally something that I was taught through various different people, Brian Tracy, Tony Robbins, to write goals. And then I just amalgamated, took the best bits that worked for me, put it into a structure.
So the stuff that you've practiced yourself.
Practiced. I'm practicing it now. In fact, I'm actually doing a live goal on like through Insta. I'm gonna actually show all the steps, all the hard. It's to do with like food. It's not gonna be money and things like that. It's gonna be something that a lot of people can relate to as well. My physique. I'm gonna show people me physically using the system, all the steps, all the challenges. Everything.
Is that when you're working with what's his name? Is it D Cooper? No, it was one of these health guys. I forgot. I saw. Is it Coop? Yes,
Coop. He's a G.
Yeah.
Man.
I've actually shouted at him. Yeah, I hollered him recently. Man. Yeah,
so, that guy is such a G. Yeah, such a G. Because okay, so let's go through it, and I'll talk.
You can see
to
I consume a lot of your content.
Yeah, man, it's good, man. It's good. It's good. Yeah. It's good. I love that, man. Mm. Seriously, man. That means a lot, man. Mm. I really do. So the system, first part of it is that where you write down what the goal is in the positive, personal, and present sense.
Yeah.
So it'll be I have, I own, I am. Yeah. Mm. So you just make your brain laser in. It's almost like a laser beam. It now goes, that is what I want. Mm. Yeah. But when you do that, what most people do is they go, okay, I want a Ferrari. Yeah. Mm. Most people would like to have a Ferrari.
Most people say they want one. Yeah.
Perfect. So you took the words out of my mouth. What you have to do now is once you say what it is you want, you've got to be able to back it up with a serious why. Mm. Because this is like your batteries. The why is your batteries. The why is the reason when everything is against you, you will push. Because that's the key there. There's no massive secret. It's when the chips are down or everything's against you or people are saying you no, you keep going, and then something will collapse for you, will capitulate, and it will give you what you want. So you've got to have what it is, but more importantly, why. So that's the first stage. Then after that, you've got to, because a lot of people run into life going, you know what, I'm gonna do it, I'm gonna work so hard, and they have no structure.
Yeah.
Now the problem with no structure is like, I'm free, but that's what happened. Yeah. And until
it's like a ship sailing without a destination.
100%. And the more you just sort of
the current.
Yeah, literally, it lasts for a little while, and then a week later, 2 weeks later, they're like, okay, I'm on to the next thing.
Yeah.
Whereas as soon as you just block out and you're more structured, you got more structure to what it is you want to do, it's very easy to follow. Mm. It's like if your parents say to you, do you know what, every day I want you to study your maths for an hour. If this went just, and I want you to do it before you have your tea, you've blocked out of time, it's very easy. The brain just goes, okay, my tea's ready soon, bam, I'm going to go and do it. Do you know what I mean? It's done. But if it's just like, if your parents went to you, go and study. Yeah. That's how people are going into life. Yeah, they're going, go and study.
Yeah.
That's how people go into their goals. They're going, yeah, this is what I want. No actual time structure. No, because you need to tell your brain needs to see it as important. And that's what happens when you block out that time. If you go every morning, my time's 4:30. I'm up at 4:30.
And what time you go in bed?
10:30, 11:00 most days. Yeah, 10:30, 11:00 most days. But 4:30 and anywhere between sort of 4:30 to 6:00-ish. Mm. Let's call it 4:45 because I leave for training to get to training for 6:00. Mm. So anywhere between that for the 1:15 is where I'm doing real concentrated brain training, work, visual, whatever it is towards my objectives and goals. Mm-hmm. So that's the second stage. Plan out when you're going to do it and how often you're going to do it, which is another thing. And the first stage is where you start to sort of put together a plan. So you start thinking, because a lot of the ideas are in our brains. They're just laying dormant because we're so lazy.
Yeah.
We don't put our brain under any stress. Yeah. So you start to actually break down the people, the groups, the organisations, the skills and knowledge and the habits that you're going to need to produce this goal. So it's just brainstorming. Mm. It's just you going to your brain, okay, let's work together, let's brainstorm, give me some ideas as to how I can achieve this goal, yeah? And then fourth stage is challenges. So not to jump, why I went to go and see Coop, who you saw, was because he's one of the people. I look at the guy and the guy has a perfect physique.
Incredible.
Physique.
It's actually through you that I found his content, and then I hollered at him straight after. So that's how it works, isn't it? Yeah.
Have to. Listen, I'll speak to him. He's an incredible guy.
Yeah.
But on top of that, I was thinking to myself, why is it I've been up and down with my weight? This is why this is a serious goal with me. It's because I don't have the education. When you don't have the education, you do anything. Yeah, same with my money. Same with money.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Don't have the education, you do anything that sounds good at the time. So I thought, you know what? I'm going to go and get educated. So a good friend put me in touch with Coop. He liked my content. I liked what he was doing. We got in contact with each other. And that's like what happens when you put yourself out there and you're going. 100%. Yeah. We connected on a serious level. But not only that, he's now teaching me and giving me things. Like, you see how I say Graham Rising? I say it all the time.
Yeah, you say
that's
it all the time. Yeah. Oh, for real?
That's him. Because he explained it to me. I was like, okay, no wonder.
Why though?
Because you say good morning. What's morning? Morning's death. why is it going to be good morning? Grand rising. Okay. I'm rising and I'm ready for the day. Yeah. Rise and shine, brother. Rise and shine. That's what we say. Do you know what I mean? But I understand. Most people think, oh, that's little. But I understand how important words are to the subconscious.
100%.
So if you're repeating good morning, good morning, good morning every single day aimlessly, some people say it ain't going to affect them. I think it's a bit deeper than that. So I'll rather now say grand rising. Do you know what I mean?
And it works for you. Yeah.
Works for me. It gives me energy. But Coop was another person I sat down with and he just told me a lot of things about food, diet, and then one thing he told me, I'm gonna release it, but one thing he told me which actually has made me eat so much better. You saw how I came with the fruit.
Yeah, you
today.
Came with the fruit. Put it in the fridge with the bananas and pineapples
and I'm eating so
water
much
as well. Yeah.
I'm not even trying. That is the power. Power of it. I'm not even trying now. I'm not saying it's a complete fix, but I'm not even trying. I found somebody who's part of the people of my goal. Yeah, Coop was one of them. There's other people that are going to be part of it. Found him. He sat down with me and he said, we're speaking for hours and there's loads of knowledge that he was giving me that I really liked. And I was, then he just said to me, you know what? It might not actually be you that is wanting this food. And I thought, what? What do you mean? Of course it's me. It's coming in my mouth. Yeah. Coming from my mindset. Yeah. Who else is it going to be? He went, pesticides.
Yeah.
I didn't know anything about
this. We don't know about bacteria in us.
Never knew nothing about this.
So there's more bacteria within our gut than there are people in this world. And they control a lot of our emotions and a lot of the actions
Mate,
that we take.
I never knew any of this. Yeah. Any
like a lot of diseases and stuff come from bacteria.
I didn't
even
know any of this. And, it goes from, and the thing about him, which I love, is he's not trying to push me to be a vegan, vegetarian, plant-based, or any of that, any label. He just wants me to live. He wants me to be able to enjoy my time with my kids. He comes from a place of love. Even as I'm saying it right now, man, I love the guy. He comes from a place, he wants me to be able to enjoy my kids, enjoy my, and live
as long
well,
as possible.
For as long as possible. And I look at him with his golden black skin.
Yeah.
And you can't ramp with it.
Mad
you
know six what I mean? Pack or eight
Mad
pack.
Eight pack. Yeah. The way he trains, he don't have to go to no gym. What subscription?
Yeah. Fuck.
Living. Mm. And I'm like, what? Great. Mm. And when he told me about pesticides, like you just said, like even now, shot, I'm like, what? So he's like, what one thing he said to me, this seed he put in my head, it was like, it isn't new. And I just felt out of control.
Yeah.
I remember he dropped me off West London. I was walking to my Uber and the whole journey from the Uber, I felt out of control. I was like, so you're trying to tell me
there's things in me that
because I'm eating all this meat.
Because they're addicted to certain stuff. So like carbohydrates, sugars and stuff like that. So yeah. And when they crave, you can't control the craving.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
And I felt, and for somebody who's so in control and loves mindset, can you imagine being told by somebody outright,
that you're not in control.
You're not in control. Can you imagine what
that's
to
When I first learned that, I was so scared because I was reading up. I came across the content because I was reading up about termites. So there's these weird termites in South America, and what they do is they control like bugs and stuff like that on the ground, and then they'll make the bugs climb up to the top of the trees so that the birds who can't penetrate the trees to get to the ground to feast, they can feast on the termite filled bugs. And then it kind of repeats itself in a cycle, because when these birds go toilet or whatever, it lands on the ground, the termites land on the ground again, all the insects and bugs will start eating them. So it's like, it's repetitive. So all these termites in the jungle or whatever, we've got these same level of bugs and bacteria within our system that are controlling us in essence. And you have to find ways of controlling them based on what you're feeding your gut.
Man, it is
some scary stuff, man.
This is it. So through this system, I knew what to do. I knew I needed to go and find people.
100%.
If you didn't know that, what am I going to say? That I'm an introvert? Do you want to live and enjoy life or not?
Yeah.
I know that I've been up and down. I've had a six pack as well. Mate, I look great, but I've been up and down. I thought, I need to get something. I need to fuck with somebody who's going to teach, educate me.
Yeah.
So Coop was that guy. One of the guys. So he sat down, he taught me. And just that one thing you said, pesticides, whatever, that was it that made my mind just go, you know what? And it's made things a lot more relatable and easier for me to understand in this journey of my goal.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
What's next in the system? Or is that the
so then that's the first part where you, that's the first part where you almost, that's the first part where you basically, you start to put together the people, the group, the organisations, the skills, knowledge. It's almost like the things you feel you're going to need to achieve your goal. The second part is where you have to start listing your challenges.
You have to what?
List your challenges.
Oh yeah, for real. Okay.
Because,
well, like your challenges in like the struggles that you're going through and stuff.
The things that you feel will prevent you from achieving the goal.
Oh, okay.
Now, this is so good because ultimately, if you had no challenges, you'd have a perfect life.
Everything
will run smoothly. Yeah. So it's just about understanding that, being open and not, and I've learned, again, this is something I've learned from doing it with so many goals. Mm. A lot of people would be so general about challenges, and general doesn't force yourself to do anything about it.
Yeah.
You have to be very specific. And the more specific you get, the more bite-sized. Do you remember that program where you say, you used to be on TV, learning bite-sized chunks?
Yeah, bite-sized chunks.
Bite-sized chunks. So same sort of thing. As soon as your brain sees it as bite-sized, it goes, let's do it. Let's have it. Mm. Let's go. Mm. So list all of your challenges. And then literally you've got the things you need to do, the things you need to avoid or undo. Then all you do for step five is you put that into a plan.
Yeah.
You put it into a plan, but you brainstorm or things that you can repeat as habits.
100%.
And then it's just affirmations is step six and visualization is step seven.
Step seven, yeah.
Done.
Yeah.
And now you've actually got your brain focused and tuned in. And when you are, when it's something that you really, really want, it's almost like Neo the Matrix. Yeah. You just start seeing things. You just start experiencing a lot more towards it.
Yeah, but I think one of the most important things as well is like, apart from putting it all down and visualizing as well, is taking action. Because what tends to happen is everyone have all of these grand plans and stuff, but then they don't actually get themselves up to really take action and make things happen and make themselves vulnerable. Because I was speaking to a gentleman a couple of weeks ago, actually. His name is Wilfred Emmanuel Jones. Extremely, extremely interesting gentleman. You should look into him.
Yeah,
so he's a black farmer. Okay. He's like a multimillionaire black farmer. Amazing story.
Sick.
And he was telling me about the importance of putting yourself out there. He was like, when he started putting himself out there and talking about what he wanted to do and what he's doing, it got him into connection with loads of people who then became in line with his goals, and he was able to then achieve so much. So it's really important that people actually get themselves up and really do
100%.
Stuff. Yeah, be active.
Spot on. Mm. But do you know what he just said? I mean, we all say the same thing. It's just what can you relate to based upon where you have been, all the things you've seen, your worldview now. Do you know what I mean? But think about what he said. He started talking about it. Mm. When you start putting yourself out there, are you talking, putting yourself out there, you're being seen, you're becoming 100%. Attractive.
Yeah.
Hence the reason, the law of attraction. Mm.
You've been doing that great right now on social media. I've seen the growth. I started following you on a couple hundred, and then all of a sudden it went into a couple thousand. I'm like, something, doing something right there. You're
Thank
really
you,
putting
man.
Yourself out there.
Thank you. But it's literally that.
Yeah, 100%. But a couple more questions. I wanted to know, like, what is your why? Like, what are you trying to do? What's your legacy? Because I know we're talking about this briefly in our messages, like talking about legacy and the message you're trying to put out in the people that you're trying to impact.
Well, for me, okay, so there's two. There's one which is more of a monetary sort of level, just to be able to provide. I've got a goal here. That's more sort of monetary.
It's the business
provide.
Side.
Business, what I want to go there. But then there's another part of me that wants to help change the psychology of certain things.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like for me, one of my sayings that I say so often is hard work is so attractive, it is fucking sexy.
Mm.
And the reason I say that is because anybody thinks that lifestyle should come so easy and so glamorous, and when that doesn't happen, because it only happens for a few, they give up on themselves. Imagine if you flip that on its head and everyone thought that it was so cool to work hard.
Yeah.
It was so cool to just really expel energy, to go out and learn, to put yourself out there, whatever, whatnot. More people would win, because that is the actual path for most things.
100%.
An overnight success takes 5 to 10 years, but you only see the overnight success. Why don't you push the 5 to 10 year journey as being sexy, as opposed to the finished garment, which might only last for another 5 to 10 years unless you've got the right training anyway.
So
for me, if you flip it on its head and just start making, my big why is, if more people can think that the process, the journey is beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
I always say the journey is beautiful. Mm-hmm. If you can get people to believe that that is it, then no matter, you ask me, negativity. I've had more downs this week than people have had in a year.
Mm.
But why can I still smile here? Can I understand it's part of the journey? Can I now buy into how attractive the journey is?
You're probably accountable as well to everything.
100%.
To, yeah.
100%. So my big why is just to make more people have that feeling of, because when things are going well, it's like, it's the journey. When things are going badly, it's the journey. And you keep going forward.
Yeah.
Because it's so easy for when things go badly to just go crippled. I've been there.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? But if you believe that, this is attractive what I'm doing, this, you know, it's sexy.
Embrace and you enjoy it. Yeah.
You enjoy it.
Yeah. Oh, that's amazing. We're quite similar in terms of like our whys. So I'm not even going to go too far into it, but it's quite the same.
Tell me, man.
I think I'm trying to change the narrative. So I'm trying to change the narrative. I'm trying to inform and educate people on like the other side of the spectrum, what they can do outside of what they've been shown. And I'm talking about people from like deprived backgrounds or people that just feel like they don't have the knowledge to understand what's happening in the world. And that's why I'm pushing out varied forms of information. So
Sick.
Like whether it be business-based, political, educational, there's so much information out there that I've come into contact with that's intrigued me. And I thought, where was all of this? Like, I didn't have a clue that this stuff existed. Do you see what I mean? I felt left out. Do you know what I mean? And feel, that sense of feeling left out, yeah, it's like it's motivating me now to then put it out there or find people who are experts in various fields to then put the content out there for people like me, the younger me, who didn't have a clue about all of this stuff. Because sometimes you coming from like obviously an ethnic background and a minority and stuff like that, you feel boxed in and there's so much that you're missing out. I mean, the world is way bigger than your estate. The world is way bigger than the street that you live in or the little circle that you have. And traveling was a big factor in terms of me learning a lot about myself and the world. So that is my why, trying to push out there, making sure that the younger me's or the younger other people out there that haven't seen this grand scheme of the world and all these varied forms of information and opportunities out there get to see it. So that is why I do it. Yeah.
So sick. Yeah. And the thing is, there's two things. There's one thing that we have to kill today.
Mm.
Kill it. We're not trying. Mm. We are doing it. So I am so powerful.
Mm.
So powerful. So what you are is you are changing the narrative.
Mm.
See? I am.
Positive affirmation.
I am teaching people about goals.
Yeah.
Yeah. I am making hard work sexy and attractive.
Sick.
I am doing it. Simple.
Sick.
Now, that now leaves me with one of two choices. I'm either doing it well or I'm doing it badly. I know which one I'm going to choose. Same for you. Yeah. Mm. That's exactly the same for you.
Yeah.
And one thing you said that resonates with me so well is this was taught to me probably 2011, the whole sort of system.
Mm.
I've adapted it. I've modified it. I've made it my own, whatever. Yeah. But I remember when my pal, very successful in his own right, owns a fashion label. He's a G. Yeah. He was like, you got to come out with this. He was telling me to do it in 2012. I was like, well, everyone knows this.
Yeah.
I thought everyone knew it.
Yeah.
And thought everyone knew it. And then he was like, on top of that, you're relatable, you dress like us, you're cool, you're into the fashion things. Mm. It will, people will receive it.
Yeah, it'll resonate.
It'll resonate badly. Yeah. But the main thing is, forget all of the distraction, the message will actually, because it helped me.
Mm.
And then I thought about it, and then I started to tell a few people,
and
they were mind blown by this whole sort of
system. You thought they already knew it. Yeah.
And I thought they already knew it.
Yeah.
And then when you start to really look into it and you really realise what people are actually told as education, it was great 50, 60, 70 years ago.
Yeah.
Then the internet came, access came.
Yeah. We live in a conceptual age now, like that whole old school age is way gone now.
It's way gone. Don't get me wrong, there's certain principles that potentially can govern certain things, but as a whole, man, we need to level up.
Yeah,
so amazing. I just thought to myself, I'm gonna just spread it.
And you've done it, amazing. So before I let you go, but we're definitely gonna catch up again because, like, man, I definitely want to sit down with you and continue checking the progress. So I mean, time permitting, because I know you're gonna become a very, very busy man. I can already foresee it. But time permitting, I really appreciate if you come back again and just keep me updated on what's going on. We can reason, sit down, chat, and so forth. But do you have anything coming up that you'd like the people to know about, or anything in particular that you're doing at the moment?
I've got another, again, the universe. I've got this, I've got a saying. It isn't actually mine. It's somebody, one of the members of my team, Paige, she come up with a saying called WEIRD, World Evolving in Right Direction. Yeah. Sure. That's our version of the law of attraction. Yeah. And I basically, we're speaking one day about a podcast that I also want to do.
Mm.
And literally the next day, someone contacted me about it. So I've got that coming up this week. Oh, and it's quite a big platform.
Yeah.
So I'm very humbled, very, 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 very grateful for that.
Yeah.
I've got my first TEDx talk.
Oh, amazing. Where about?
TEDx talk. So it's in West London.
Which one? Is it?
So it's Houston one? It's Wealthfinity Events.
Okay.
I'll send you the link.
I appreciate it. I'm going to try to catch the tickets.
I've got 10 minutes to just give energy, my heart, my soul to people.
You got it.
Do you know what? The thing is, man, I feel like I was... it's funny. My missus and my mum was like, you're born to do this, man.
Yeah.
From day to, this was you, man. Everything else has been, you've been gathering experiences so that when you speak, it comes from your heart.
Yeah.
Done.
That's the thing. All of our ups and downs and our journeys are a part of the experience of us becoming who we're supposed to become. So definitely it was all part of it. Yeah.
Apart from that, I'm going to do, there's a couple of events I'm going to do just to give back to people.
Mm.
I want to do an event whereby I can invite people, because it's mad, man. People just like think, monetize it. How can you monetize it? For me, that's so short-sighted. I don't want it, man.
Yeah,
I don't care for that, man. Mm. I know what money brings.
If you put out the value down, out there, the rest will come.
100%.
Like, people go out there chasing the money first, monetize this, monetize that. Nah.
But do you know what? I can't diss people because I get it, man. Like, if you're in a position where you've never had it, I guess, again, big up to my dad for that. Mm. And also the fact that I've experienced, where you've experienced a bit of it, you can almost...
Well, you experience more than a bit. Yeah. Saying a bit will humble you. Yeah.
But you can actually go, you know what? That's cool.
Yeah.
And it'll be nice.
Mm.
Let's do the bigger picture. Let's do the Matrix Neo shit.
Yeah, nice, nice. I really appreciate you coming down. I don't really want, obviously, I know you're a busy man. I don't really want to hold you too tough. I know you've got probably another podcast to record and a couple of business but we're definitely going to catch up again, and I really appreciate it, man. Welcome to listening.
Thank you very appreciate much, man.
Love, brother. Love.
Love.
Yeah. Oh, man, that's...
Man, I thoroughly enjoyed that, man.
Yeah, no, definitely. You know what?